Hello there, welcome to Fridays at Noon. I'm Michael Chen, the executive producer and director for this talk show series. Fridays at Noon is a bi-weekly lunch and learn series that offers education on professional development topics to the University of Denver employees. For more information and to view past videos, please visit du.edu/HR and click on the People Development link. Now, sit back, relax, and enjoy the rest of the show.
And bring your lunch.
Oh, and bring your lunch.
Welcome to Fridays at Noon. My name is Greg Giesen, Manager of People Development, and today we're going to be talking about DU's Title IX program and Equal Opportunity program. And I'm fortunate enough to be joined by Jean McAllister, Director of Title IX, and Laura Maresca, Director of Equal Opportunity. So welcome, you two.
Thank you, Greg.
Laura, let me begin with you. Give us an overview of Equal Opportunity and kind of what they do.
Sure. The Office of Equal Opportunity is responsible for ensuring compliance with the university's anti-discrimination policies in the following regard: policies related to race, color, national origin, age, religion, disability, and genetic information, and veteran status. So we're also responsible for ensuring full compliance with state, federal, and local laws that relate to those discrimination statutes.
Okay, and we'll get much more involved, of course, in both areas. Mm-hmm. Jean, can you give us an overview of Title IX?
Yes. Title IX does the partner work to equal opportunity by enforcing the university's policies related to discrimination, harassment, or violence based on gender. And that includes gender presentation, in sexual orientation, and parenting or pregnancy status as well. And we do the same things in that we're working toward developing a gender equitable campus. We enforce violations of our policies, our non-discrimination policies on campus, and we are tasked with conducting investigations when those policies are violated.
So some people get confused over Title VII and Title IX. Can you explain the difference a little bit?
Actually, I'm going to ask Laura to talk first about Title VII, because that applies to employees primarily, and then I'll talk some about Title IX.
Sure. So Title VII is part of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and it prohibits discrimination in the workplace on the basis of race, color, national origin. It includes gender. Mm-hmm. It applies to businesses with 15 or more employees, and it includes businesses such as state, local governments. It includes universities. Basically, again, any employer with over 15 employees.
And Title IX is a part of the Civil Rights Act of 1972 as amended, which specifically identifies the requirement to develop equity initially in gender-based programming. Many people think of it as the law that created equity, more equity in sports for women's sports programs, because that's what was initially passed to address. And over the last years, its focus has expanded to include any kind of gender-based discrimination, harassment, or violence, including sexual assault, relationship violence, and stalking.
Okay, thank you.
So one interesting difference is that Title VII, while it covers gender discrimination as well, does not, the federal statute does not cover sexual orientation discrimination at this time.
Okay.
Which is one difference from the way our policy, and I think the way Title IX operates.
Yes, right, absolutely.
So what's similar about both your services and what's different?
So there's a lot that's similar. So Title IX and Equal Opportunity both use the same procedural guidelines in terms of how we do our jobs and enforce what we do. I think the primary difference is that, as Jean described, Title IX really covers gender and gender-related issues, and then EO covers those remaining areas that we discussed. Jean, was there?
And there's one other relatively major difference, which is that under Title IX, employees of educational institutions, and that includes anyone who may respond to students or be responsible for supervising students, so resident assistants in the dorms, graduate teaching assistants, graduate research assistants, as well as full-time faculty and mm-hmm. staff, are responsible for communicating information if the university knows or has reason to know that there's been an incident of gender-based discrimination, harassment, or violence. So they're essentially mandatory reporters. All of our faculty and staff are required by law to report to us if they receive a report relating to any of those issues.
Okay.
And while we strongly encourage reporting in all of the areas related to the protected classes that Laura serves, we don't have the same legal mandate for there to be mandatory yeah. reporting across all areas, including yeah. students.
And it's possible that you could share the same client, right? Because it could be multiple concerns.
I think that that's a pretty common intersection, actually.
Yeah.
So often somebody will come in and they'll have claims that cover or span both Title IX issues as well as our other equal opportunity
yeah.
protected statuses,
yeah.
and we tend to work those cases together.
So Laura, what are the most common concerns that would come to you?
That's a good question. I think, you know, they're so varied at this point. I would say that I get concerns from first, just to clarify, from faculty, staff, students. They can come in from any member of the DU community or from anyone who's had an interaction with a member of the DU community, so a vendor, for example, or someone who's coming onto campus for some other type of service. I would say an example of maybe a typical concern might be someone like a student who has a disability, who feels their accommodations not being honored by the academic unit, for example.
Mm-hmm. And Jean, what about you? What's the most common type of concerns that you get?
Well, like Laura, we have very broad
yeah.
disparity in types of concerns. I have everything from students who perceive that they don't have access to the same assignments or training based on their gender that other mm-hmm. students in their mm-hmm. area does, or that a professor may be inclined to call on or give the good projects to certain gender and not to the other. But I also have a large number of reports of sexual assault on campus where someone has experienced some sort of sexual trauma or potential relationship violence mm-hmm. on campus. So I have that sort of full range,
yeah.
and of course they're very different. Our procedures for addressing them are very similar, but the needs of the people presenting may be very different
yeah.
and the solutions may be very different.
Well, and this is kind of a question for both of you. So when somebody does bring a concern, like what do you initially do?
I think I'll start with that, Jean, and then you can add, because I know there's some unique aspects to what you do in this regard that might differ from what I would do. The first thing that we would do is have an intake with the individual to try and gain an understanding of what their concerns are. We explain our process to them. We provide them information on what the process looks like. We make sure there's no immediate actions that the university needs to take to prevent ongoing mm-hmm. or further harm to an individual. And we also strive to understand what resolution fits best for the person and how they like to proceed and what they hope the outcomes might look like.
Mm-hmm. And I say that would be the same mm-hmm. For Title IX. In some cases, though, Title IX reports come from people who are not the primary person who's experienced mm-hmm. the harm, particularly issues related to sexual assault. We often get a third-party report. And then before meeting with the person, I do an outreach. And particularly students have asked that those outreach be written outreach so that they're not surprised by a phone call about something that was incredibly traumatic during the middle of a day.
Yeah.
So I'll do an outreach initially indicating that I received a concern, offering our resources that are available on campus to provide support, both confidential mm-hmm. and non-confidential support, so they have a choice about how they seek
yeah.
assistance, and then offering to go through our policies and procedures. I also let people know that they're not required to meet with us. That's not a requirement of our students, and that they and that's somewhat different in employee circumstances in some cases. Laura can speak to that. But they have a right to determine the degree to which they want to participate in any of the options for resolving circumstances, unless a couple of things are present. If I've identified that there are cases of harm imposed on someone related to gender or discrimination or violence, and that that has happened before by that same party, or there have been multiple mm-hmm. reports, I may decide to initiate a university-based investigation, regardless of whether any of the individuals has decided they want to move forward. I would always invite those individuals to be interviewed as witnesses, but they're not required to. In almost every case, when someone realizes someone else has been harmed, they do agree to participate mm-hmm. in those sorts of investigations. But that is something that our responsibility to maintain a safe campus
right.
Requires that we do when we identify patterns.
Sure. So Laura, if you were going to give some advice, when should people call you?
Well, I think we always like to err on the side of asking people to call us and to mm-hmm. contact us if they have any concern that falls under the areas that we cover. Sometimes I refer to what's called the icky factor. So mm-hmm. I may say, don't wait to call till you think something's escalated to the point where you say, I know this is a violation, or mm-hmm. I feel confident this must be a violation of the law or policy. That's not our only objective. Our objective is also to bring the campus environment to a place where we're consistent with our anti-discrimination policies and goals, which involves a lot of proactive mm-hmm. Outreach and work. Because of that, we do like people to come forward, even with something that would seem maybe minor, or they're not sure if it's a violation. It just made them feel uncomfortable. And oftentimes, we can provide assistance with that. We also keep track of all of the complaints that come into us. So part of our objective is to understand what the climate of the university looks like. And if people don't come and chat with us, even if it's just an informal resolution, we don't have a record.
Yeah. Yeah. So if they're in doubt, definitely call.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And Jean, same thing for you or anything different?
Same thing for me. And one slightly different thing, not only if you have something that you're not sure about, or if you have something you would like to start working on that you think mm-hmm. would create a more equitable or safe campus, we'd like to help you do that proactively.
Yeah.
We don't need there to be a problem report. We'd like to help build culture and programs that support equity, that help bystander
yeah.
or ally education prior to any specific problem being identified.
Yeah.
And I guess the other thing I would say, when it's something related to gender-based violence, you don't need to do any level of investigation. That's our responsibility. Just let us know right away. We will do the outreach. We do the investigation. And it's very important that people mm-hmm. not take it upon themselves to try to intervene with those circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't want someone, whether they were angry or wanting to protect the person reaching out to a potential respondent in an investigation or someone where there are allegations, because they have rights as well, and we have responsibilities to do those things in specific ways.
Well, and you've kind of alluded to this a couple times, but is there a criteria for when an investigation needs to go forward?
There are several. If we believe that there is danger to others on campus
mm-hmm.
or danger of a circumstance where discrimination, harassment, or violence will be continued and can't be
mm-hmm.
stopped by a lesser intervention, a more alternative intervention, then we do have a requirement that we initiate a response that includes an investigation. And in those circumstances, and then also those places where there are patterns of
mm-hmm.
behavior that we've
right.
identified.
Mm-hmm.
And in those circumstances, we initiate what's called a university-based investigation. Also, if we meet with someone in that initial intake meeting that Laura described, and what they described to us is something that, if it were investigated and determined to be true, and there is a factual basis that they're
mm-hmm.
presenting, we're not saying we determine that, and they want to move forward, then we can initiate an investigation. So someone can say, this is serious enough to me, and if we determine that it meets our sufficiency standards, then we can also initiate an investigation.
What about on your end? Similar, different?
I think it's pretty much exactly the same. I mean, the cases that I've come across so far, really what I'm examining is the sufficiency standard that Jean discussed. And as she pointed out, it's important to know that we take it at face value when it comes in, just in terms of making that determination. Mm-hmm. We don't make a decision or prejudge whether something happened or didn't happen, but we're just really looking at, are the facts that were brought forward such that if they were true, the way they were explained, would that constitute a violation of university policy?
Yeah, yeah. And are there very specific steps when an investigation does happen?
Yes, there are.
And what might those be?
Well, the initial steps are to do a formal investigative interview. We have two civil rights trained investigators on staff that the university employs, and we refer our investigations to them. They would do an initial interview with the party who's raising the concern. We call that person the complainant in the investigation process. And the reason they interview that person first is they need to understand what facts they're investigating, so they need to understand what the concern is. Then I, as Title IX coordinator, would notice or provide a written notice to the person who's alleged to have violated the policy that we're initiating an investigation, that we are not saying there's been a finding made. We're merely investigating, and I offer to go over our policies and procedures with them so they understand their rights in the process as well. Each party is allowed to offer other witnesses, other evidence. Once I meet with the respondent, they would then be interviewed by the investigators, and then the investigators review other evidence. They may interview other parties that have been offered, and they will prepare what's called a preliminary report. The preliminary report should include all of the evidence they've reviewed, and both the complainant and respondent are allowed to review every single piece of that: personal statements, physical evidence, anything they have, and offer additional evidence after that review so that everyone has a right to understand fully what's been investigated and respond to any of the material. And then they prepare a final report that would make a determination whether it's more likely or less likely that a university policy has been violated. We use a preponderance of evidence standard, which is 50% plus a little bit. It's not the beyond a reasonable doubt standard you hear about on television and courtroom dramas.
Sure.
And then in circumstances where there are findings that policy's been violated, they go out of our office to other places for what people might identify as sanctions, what we call outcomes or corrective actions. And maybe, Laura, you'd like to talk about where those go?
I think it depends on whether you're dealing with a faculty or you're dealing with a student, but they have different places that they'll go. I wanted to mention one thing, though, before I forget, and just comment that is of interest to me. So I practiced in private practice before I came to DU and did a lot of workplace investigations. That was one of the primary things I did. And one of the things that I found so interesting about the process here is that it is a very, very equitable process, and the procedures that are in place, and it's a very transparent process. So there are a lot of places where you would do, for many different employers, where you would do a workplace investigation where nobody would have the opportunity to review anybody's statement. Nobody would have the opportunity to review an initial review of a report. So it's been a very interesting change, and I think one that brings a lot of, like I said, transparency that's to the process that should give people a very high comfort level about what's happening.
Who do you use for investigators?
I use the same. We have the same investigators that work on on the Title IX side as well as the Equal Opportunity side. We also engage external investigators from time to time if we have a workload issue or if there's a particular, there may be another reason why we would want to go external, but we'll do that as well.
So, okay, to get into a specific scenario, Jean, if a student or coworker confides, let's say, to a staff or faculty about a sexual harassment incident, what responsibility does that staff or faculty have at that point?
That's a really good question. They have a direct responsibility to report that incident to the Office of Title IX. And the way they can do that is threefold. They can go to the Title IX website at DU, du.edu/Title IX, and they will be taken to our web pages. And in the upper right-hand corner, there's a red button that says Submit a Report. They can click on that and fill out a written report and push Send, and it will come directly to our office. Sometimes people are confused. Is this Title IX? Is this EO? They should know they don't need to be able to tell the difference. We'll sort that out on our end. And so you can do the exact same thing for an equal opportunity report. They could also call me by telephone to report or email me. I don't want there ever to be a block against someone reporting. But so we have multiple ways that they can do that. And I've had people show up knocking on my door to make a report, and I welcome that as well.
Laura, what if somebody, they're confiding in someone, but they're like, can you please not tell anybody?
You know, and that's probably a bigger issue on Jean's side of the fence. So I will let Jean, because I know she wants to make sure she shares information about confidential reporting. On the EO side, we don't really have, I think Jean mentioned this earlier, we don't really have a requirement that people report yet. And there's not a statutory mandate, but we do advise that people should be reporting. In terms of what I tell people when they come to talk to me, I tell them, I never guarantee anybody complete confidentiality. What I tell them I provide is privacy, which means only people with a need to know would receive information that I receive. And I usually say, my example I give is, well, if you come in and you tell me someone's committing embezzlement, you've asked me for confidentiality first. Obviously, I need to do something on behalf of the university about that. But in terms of at the university at large, Jean may want to address that specific question, because it does have implications for Title IX.
Absolutely. And what I would say is that anybody who's an employee should, in their role at some point, be saying to people, on matters related to gender-based discrimination, harassment, or violence, I'm a mandatory reporter. So if someone approaches you and says, I really need to talk, but I need you not to talk to anyone, in your role as a university staff person or a faculty member or an employee, you need to say, I'd love to be able to talk with you confidentially, but there are some things about which I can't. And if it's related to anything about gender violence, I have to report that, or Title IX, or however you want to frame that. I can make sure you get referred to someone who's a confidential resource if you really don't want anyone to know about that. And they can either go on our website to look at the information about confidential resources, or they might remember that the Center for Advocacy, Prevention, and Empowerment, the Health and Counseling Center, and the University Chaplain are the three confidential resources where people can speak about Title IX matters without being reported to anyone. So you always want to say, not don't stop talking, but yes, I want you to be able to talk. I want you to be able to talk to the right person for what your needs are at this time.
So when a formal investigation's going on, is what advice do you have for the departments? You know, because it's probably awkward.
It is. It can be a really difficult situation for any department going through an investigation, for any group of people. We often advise the people who are the managers of that group to maintain neutrality. It's often tempting for someone to say, especially if they've worked for a long time with one person, to say, oh, I know you, there's no way you could have done this, or I know you would never lie, I know this really happened. But they have to really try and refrain from making those judgmental statements. It's very appropriate to provide support to both people. That's another thing we try to emphasize, is that we don't want to just support one person and not another if it's between two people in a department. And we also really encourage people to respect the privacy of those involved, because it's a very, if there is an investigation going on, I think both parties feel very vulnerable. And the less that people talk about it, or the less that people, you know, give opinions and whatnot, the better.
And I would just add to that that sometimes people feel like they need to protect someone, or in some way protect them from consequences. And it's really important that the support they include, that they give people, says, I know this must be really difficult. I'm sorry you're going through this. And did the people at EO or Title IX offer you some resources? Can I help you get connected with one of those support resources? You can talk to me about your feelings. I can't discuss the content of the investigation with you.
Yeah.
It's really important that people understand those sorts of things. And for both parties, it's important not to say things like, did you do this? Did you do this? Did you do this? Because we often want to make sure they did everything we think should be done. That can feel very blaming. And it's also important not to say things like, what were you thinking? Or other things that can imply that someone's responsible. Yeah. Again, in either circumstance, even though that may be what we're thinking. And if you have those kinds of questions, it's really appropriate to contact either Laura or I to talk about your own response to that if you're in a situation of being a manager, but to try not to communicate those thoughts to the parties, because often they're asking those questions themselves and it can feel like a very strong lack of support.
You know, interestingly, from an investigatory perspective, from an investigator's perspective, one of the most difficult things that I've encountered before doing investigations is when there's been a lot of talk among people before they come in to see me, it has a very profound impact on what a witness, on witness recollection. So in other words, one of the most important things when you're conducting an investigation is to understand what that person actually observed as a witness, what their personal observations were firsthand, not what someone told them. Memory is a very tricky thing. And sometimes people, when they're told, when they have a conversation with someone after the fact, will assume that memory as their own. And it can cause a lot of problems. And for an investigator, you really have to tease that out and it can become problematic.
So clearly, the sooner they contact either of your offices, the better, because you can give them guidelines, coaching a little bit on how to do those kind of things. Because otherwise, you have to just a lot of coffee talk and water cooler conversation, which probably happens before it gets to you in some cases. Like you said, that creates a little bit of a problem. Yeah. What about, and I know this is a sensitive issue, the bystander, like, what do you tell somebody who maybe witnessed something and they're not sure what to do, or what do you say?
In sexual assault arena, the gender-based violence arena, we call people bystanders. In the arena related to racial discrimination or bias incidents of other kinds, we often talk about allies. And essentially, they serve the same sort of purpose.
Right.
We know that it's less likely that discriminatory behavior happens when the culture has people who feel willing to speak up when minor infractions are happening. We obviously want people to be able to observe and notice if someone is feeling left out, pushed out, labeled in some way. I think it's easier for people when there's some overt discriminatory action, like calling someone a name or something like that. I think we have a campus where people are more likely to speak up and say, hey, that's not the kind of language we want to use, even if you're mad. But often it's things like, notice if somebody, it looks like they're feeling excluded or intimidated. Walking up to stand next to someone can be an act of support.
Okay.
Saying, have you thought about this, can be a way of being a bystander. And of course, when we're talking about younger students who may be in circumstances where people are drinking or using drugs, making sure that somebody who has been drinking or using drugs is not in a circumstance where they might be alone with someone when they're not in a place where they could actually consent to any kind of behavior, even though they may think they're having fun. Kind of the standard approach is, if you wouldn't let your baby sister or baby brother who you love dearly get in a car and drive, you probably shouldn't let them go off alone with anyone either.
So I would say, you know, we try to encourage people to, we do want to create a climate and a culture, right, where we all are agreeing to a certain level of normative behavior that supports the anti-discrimination policies of the university. Of course, we'd never want anybody to put themselves in a position where they may be concerned about their own personal welfare or harm. They can always call campus safety if you're a bystander to something that seems inappropriate and is frightening, if it rises to that level.
Yes.
And you can also, if it's an ongoing thing like a workplace thing or something that's going on in a classroom, you can call us and we can offer, because sometimes things are very situational. And so we can offer strategies. That's another thing Jean and I can do, is offer strategies that might help them. You know, I think sometimes where I've encountered this in the past as well, with trying to support bystanders or allies showing support, is when an off-color joke is told in a work group, or if someone notices in meeting that a female employee is asked to, you know, pour the glasses of water or distribute the photocopies mm-hmm. routinely, you know, sometimes mm-hmm. that's a good place to step in, you know, where someone could say, I can get that, or I can photocopy that, or why don't, mm-hmm. you're closer to the door, why don't you do that? You know, and there's some small behaviors that I think people can do to show their allyship or support, mm-hmm. Like that.
Okay. Can either of you think of a common discriminatory act that people don't realize is right offhand might be discriminatory? Are there any that come to mind?
Well, there are a number around gender or sexual orientation or gender identity. You may hear someone ranking the looks of a group of people in the room, male or female, by number. That, while some okay. people may see that as simple, you know, mm-hmm. young people having fun, that can be yeah. really harmful or mm-hmm. detrimental. Or somebody may say, oh, he just does that because he's a queen. That can be seen as discriminatory. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's really important that we understand that labels and categories, when we talk about people in those ways, often may be unconscious discriminatory behaviors.
Yeah.
You know, I would just add to that that I think when you're talking about what people may not realize is an act of discrimination, I might say that context sometimes has a difference, mm-hmm. Or people don't realize context. So our university policies prohibit discrimination in all aspects of employment, which, and people may understand, well, hiring and termination, that makes sense. But things like access to training opportunities, things like opportunities to take leave in different ways, you know, when you're allowed to take vacation time, things like that. So aspects of someone's employment that may not necessarily, people may not realize is are things that you can run afoul of our anti-discrimination yeah. policies are important to keep in mind.
Talk about some of the education and preventive maintenance that you guys are either doing or planning on doing.
Well, we have the Office of Title IX works with many partners on campus, yeah. and we have partners who are doing a lot of education and training. The Office of Title IX does training related to Title IX. We do training right. related to equity. We can train about issues of consent, our policies mm-hmm. and procedures. But we also work with the Center for Advocacy, Prevention, and Empowerment, and they do training, the BOSS training, our bystander intervention training, that's can be scheduled for any group on campus. Okay. They do how to support a survivor training that can be scheduled for nice. Any group on campus, okay. because we know when survivors have support, they're more likely to report. We're more likely to be able to stop the behaviors. We also work with campus safety, who can do short, simple self-defense courses. They have a 90-minute course. They have a course for how to use mace, although I want to be really clear that the large majority of sexual violence happens between people who know one another, not from strangers. Mm-hmm. And they also have a rape defense course specifically that's a longer course that can be done for groups. And they've done some simple training on things like street harassment. Depending on where people have their internship, sometimes they're exposed to more of that than they may be on campus. So our partners have great, and then the Health and Counseling Center does a lot of training about education about alcohol and the relationship between alcohol, the PALS program, the relationship between alcohol and sexual mm-hmm. violence. So we have great training across the campus, and of course we need to increase and improve that, yeah. and we'll be working on broadening our bystander and ally training specifically.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Yeah, so similar to Jean, I work with a lot of partners around the university. Right. A couple of specific initiatives that I'm working on right now are trying to put together a bias incident response team or protocol for the university, as well as working on faculty hiring guidelines from a diversity and inclusive excellence perspective.
Wow, okay. All right, so here's a question that wasn't on the sheet. Laura, I'll go first with you. The best part and most challenging part of your job?
The best part, well, the most challenging part, I think, is sometimes people really catch you off guard in their behaviors. And, you know, I've been doing this work for a very, very long time, for decades. And I always say I should never say I'm surprised at something that somebody will do or say, but yet I am every day, not every day, I frequently get surprised. And I tend to, in my mind, think that as a culture, we may be up here when maybe we're really not there yet. And so that's probably one of the more challenging aspects of the job. I think for me, one of the most rewarding aspects of the job is that you're actually making an impact on people's lives on an individual level, as well as, I think, on a community level. And I find that very rewarding.
Same question.
Well, I would echo much of what Laura said. I think one of my biggest challenges is when I see people who I think the assumption Laura referenced, that I think we're on the same page and we've really moved our culture, and people within the culture that may have some misinformation or misperceptions that kind of spill out periodically. I think that's challenging for me because I love the people I work with and I love our community, and I really want to assume that everyone's in a good place. It's easier for me to understand that students may not be there yet sometimes than it is if it's an administrator or a faculty member or something. I think that's challenging, or a colleague of mine at times. But I also think that there is an incredible reward. We see the greatest resilience in people. Sometimes we see a bit of the underbelly of what the worst of the worst things that people might do to one another here. But we also see incredible resilience. Yeah. We see incredible capacity for change and for building community and incredibly supportive responses. Yeah. So we get to see a little bit of the worst, but we get to see a whole lot of the best.
Now, you guys have already kind of alluded to the other resources, but just another shout-out to the resources that you particularly collaborate with on campus.
I don't think we mentioned the Center for Multicultural Excellence. Mm-hmm. They're a partner for both Jean and I, and that's another one I would add. I think we covered a lot of them.
I think we did. I just would say again that people do have access to confidential resources in either of these arenas. The Center for Advocacy, Prevention, and Empowerment specifically focuses on gender-based harassment and violence. But our Health and Counseling Center has great support for people. They have our EAP program for faculty and staff. And then our university chaplain is also a confidential resource. And people don't have to be any particular faith background to see our university chaplain. He has a very broad and supportive approach to the support that he offers.
We also have an ombuds on campus who is a really good resource in terms of directing people to where they need to go, and she has a very good understanding of how the university works and how to navigate around the university. So I think she's a good resource as well.
And she can provide confidential help, not related to Title IX, but related to other kinds of problems on the university. So it's a different sort of confidential resource, but sometimes people just want to talk about solutions without having to talk to anybody that they want to work with on the solution.
Yeah. So do either of you, or can you think of a story that kind of had a positive ending to it?
I can think of a number of them. I think maybe on a small level, something, and again, this goes back to what I find rewarding about the job, but a simple situation where someone came to talk to me, and again, this would be one of those circumstances that didn't rise to the level of a policy violation, but it made this person uncomfortable. And we talked through it and agreed that the best resolution would be for me to have an outreach to the other person that was involved in this situation. And through the process of this discussion with both people and then getting both people together, the person who had made the comments that were the subject of our discussion said that she honestly had no idea that what she said had offended, and she truly felt really bad about the situation, and talked a lot about her own behavior changes and things she could do differently. And I think that was very gratifying to the person who brought the concern forward.
Yeah.
And I think it was also a moment, an aha moment for the other person who said, I had no idea, you know? Mm-hmm. And so to see those, the light bulbs going off and to see the other person feeling yeah. validated was a real success, I think.
How about you?
Well, I had an experience where a student hadn't felt supported when in a response to a sexual trauma circumstance by a particular environment at the university. And the student actually came back as an alum and asked to do an alternative resolution where that person just wanted to share what they felt could have been more supportive. And there was some consternation from the group that was being asked to have the discussion. We talked about discussions don't have to be scary, nobody's in trouble. And they agreed to have the discussion and actually made some changes in the way they operate here at the university as a result of that discussion and communicated that they thought it was very helpful. But the really wonderful thing was that there was another circumstance, unfortunately, although we consider reports positive because we know they're happening. And this group did everything right. And I saw this person who had asked to do the initial resolution at a community meeting and was able to say, I have actually been able to observe positive change in the way this group operates. And that person said, that made my year.
Nice.
Really felt validated about yeah. her courage to come back and talk about what her needs were. So again, you see incredible resilience in the ability to embrace change.
Yeah. Well, thank you both for being a part of this. Now, how do they get a hold of you, Jean?
They get a hold of me at my email address, which is jean.mcallister@du.edu at 303-871-7481, or on the Title IX webpage, my contact information is available there.
And Laura?
I was going to say the same thing. I think the easiest way to contact me is to go to the EO webpage, which is under Human Resources. And as Jean alluded to, there's a form there that you can fill out. There's our email addresses, our phone numbers. We even have an equal opportunity at DU web or email address that, mm-hmm. that's unique. And that information is on there also. So that's the best place to go to get contact information.
All right.
Absolutely. And we have a Title IX web address as well, and all of that information is on the Title IX webpage.
All right. Well, and thank you to all of you for joining us today, and we'll be back in 2 weeks. Thank you very much.